Thank you, Roger. Okay, let's go ahead. We will start out in 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. Is that wind that I hear? A little bit? Okay. It's interesting. All right, this is responding rightly. Part two. Once again, let's just ask the Lord to open our eyes because we need our eyes open. Heavenly Father, I pray that you just guide now. As we look into your word, we don't want to cheat your word. We don't want to cut it short. We want to have an understanding of what you say. So use this time, I pray. And thank you for these dear folks. When the call for a time of prayer went out, they have responded. Lord, that so encourages me. So Lord, use us, your children, as we intercede and also as we glean from your word. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. You know, when an enemy is going to attack, he schemes. He knows how to go for possible potential weak points. Satan, it's obvious, it's more than obvious, has schemes when it comes to those three entities that God founded. One of those is the family. Another is government. Another one is the local church. We see two of those entities here. We started out with the world responding rightly in the world, but now we're going to be looking at the family. Responding rightly in the family is where we begin. The first thing is the heart of the home. Let me explain. The man is the head of the home, but the woman is the heart. That is so very true. There's an attitude that Peter, through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, desires. He says, ladies, here's what you can do. First of all, he takes note of what she sows. What she sows. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands. The word subjection there is a military word meaning to place under rank. Submission has to do with order and authority, not evaluation. My wife is smarter than I am. Like I've told you before, when we go, yes, honey, you are, and we're going to have an argument right now. It's going to go around the world. You got to understand that. I said, you know, when we graduated from college, she graduated who's who, I graduated who's he. You know, that's just the way it is. So she submitted and said, I'm going to help this guy out because my soul does he need help. This command does not require women to be subordinate to men in general, but to their husbands as a function of order within the home. Now, take note of that. Islam makes sure that women, no matter who the man is, she is beaten down. Nobody's going to beat my wife down. And the fact of the matter is, submission has nothing to do with that. My wife is the heart of our home. Guys, let's just figure it. Look, I know if something happened to me, there'd be a few tears shed and life goes on. If something happened to my wife, the Rogers family would absolutely, I mean, it's like, oh my soul, what are we going to do? You know, Heather, Michael, Julie, when it comes to things that are really needed, guess who they text? You know, it's like the same thing, you know, when we get on FaceTime, you know, they see, you know, I get on there and they get the big smile and they go, where's Nana? Here, you know. So likewise, the word likewise here is used in verses 1 through 7. It means in the same manner or in like manner. It speaks of Christ's example from the previous chapter. See, he was submissive to the Father's will. Everybody is submissive to somebody. There is not an occasion on earth in the Word where somebody says, I'm free. There's only one person, and that's God. In the very same way, the husband submits himself to the Father by loving his wife as Christ loved the church. So there is never a situation where somebody can lord their authority over someone else. Never. Zip, zilch, nada. So what we have here is a culture, if you will, a structure that the Lord, when he created it to have a head and a following and so forth. You find that in civil government. You find that in business. You find that everywhere, including the church and including the family, including the home. I've said this before, and I still mean it. I'll never marry a couple where the wife doesn't say that she'll obey. If she won't say that, I won't marry them. Now, we usually take care of that through the counseling. But again, there needs to be, and if he doesn't say that he's going to love her as Christ loved the church, we go back on that too, in a big way. So when it comes to where we begin in 1 Peter chapter 3, we start with the woman, what she sows. Why? Because of what he, the husband, sees. Let's go again to verse 1. Be in subjection to your own husband. Watch what he sees. That if, even if, it's saying, that's what that means, even if any obey not. If any of those husbands obey not, that word has the idea of obstinate towards truth. Now, this is where wives can get encouragement. Even if he's obstinate for the truth and he won't listen, if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation, the manner of life of the wives. Without the direct preaching of the word, the message of what happens takes place. That's why, remember when Chuck Coffey was here? His wife got saved. He says, you know, and foul-mouthed at the time, I'm leaving you. I'm not going to be married to some Christian woman. And it was 2 years until he wound up in a crisis of his own where that little gal of his took him and sat him down at the sofa, and he on his knees before her trusted Christ as Savior. And that Marine got saved. And ever since that time, if he said it once, he said it 10,000 times. Whether he emails me or you know, he texts me or whatever, you know, it's a shame that your wife, that Bernie doesn't love you as much as Lenora loves me. I've heard that. Chuck, if you're listening, I'm telling you what. But watch this. Look at verse 2. While they behold... And the word behold means very attentively, they're watching. While they behold your chaste or pure conversation, again, manner of life, coupled with fear or reverence. You see, if the husband sees that the wife is living a certain way, not because of him, but because of God, there's a difference. It's one thing to cower before man. It's another thing to reverence before God. Why was it that through the Old Testament we would see men of God, like Daniel, who before God purposed in his heart, I'm not going to eat the king's meat. That was not fear of man. Fear of man would say, hey, I'm not going to do anything you want. Reverence towards God says, I'm going to obey his commands. I'm going to obey his commands. So, regarding her attitude, what she sows and what he sees. Not only it's that, but it's also regarding her attire. Look at, again, what she sows. Verse 3, who's adorning? The word cosmos is used there. That's when we talk about order in the universe, the order of things. In this case, the order of the Christian life. The opposite of this is chaos. Who's adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of the plaiting or literally tying of knots in the hair and of wearing of gold or of putting on of apparel. That's not how she's trying to win him. But let it be, and see, this is what God knows. This is what he sees. Verse 4, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corrupt, not trying to use the flesh to win by to things of the Spirit, but to use the Spirit to win to the Spirit. That's why a church doesn't use the flesh to try to get people to repent from the flesh and believe Christ in the Spirit. You just don't use that. You use the power of God. But let it be the hidden man of the heart and that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit. Now, the word meek doesn't mean Casper milk toast. The word meek is power under control. You talk about a meek horse. A horse can take, I mean, it's, you know, hundreds of pounds of solid muscle. But the horse, when broken, is under control, even of somebody that is much smaller than them. It's the same thing here, a meek, under control, and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. Now, the world might not recognize that. Government might not recognize that. The entertainment industry might not recognize that. But one day, when you die, when you make that great change, the final call, like we were talking about this morning, you're not going to stand before NBC, ABC, CBS, Fox News, or whoever else. You're going to stand before God. Amen? And so for that, hey, I would rather wait and stand before God and hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant, than have the world pat me on the back, and I know you would too. Amen? That's what I absolutely. The world prizes costly things. The world prizes money, fame, fortune. I'm fascinated by the city of Dubai. I'm fascinated by it because they have taken oil money, and in the middle of a place where it is so incredibly hot, they have built an absolute beautiful city. Well, at least what they try to showcase. It's interesting that kind of tucked away, it's not that pretty and it's not that nice. They have brought in people that have worked there from Pakistan and other places. They have absolutely misused and abused construction workers, trying to build something that looks like this gorgeous edifice before the world. It's a facade. It's not real. It's not there. Hey, listen, the world lifts that kind of thing up. What is hidden is what God, what he prizes. And that's one of the things that we're talking about here. You know, we might be solid in our doctrine, but if we're not careful, we can defeat that with our dress. So ladies and men, be careful. Psalm 104:2, who covers thyself with light as with a garment? Light comes within from within by God. It's part of his essence. That's what women are encouraged to do, and men, by the way. Can't win them with the flesh. You just can't win the husband. Let's go to this, verse 5. Now we're remembering another time. Verse 5. For after this manner in the old time, the holy, or the set apart, women also, who trusted, who hoped in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed, over a long period of time, obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. You need not be afraid. You know, when you set yourself walking before the Lord, he'll take care of you. He'll absolutely take care of you. Now, what about the difficulties? I got to say this up front. I am not advocating, and the Bible does not advocate either, a woman to stay in an abusive situation. Not talking about that. We're talking about a situation where the husband is observing, not abusing. In that case, when it comes to abuse, the church can step in and the authorities can step in. Amen? I find it so sad. Went into the doctor myself this last week, and now, I mean, more than ever, in fact, twice when I was there this last Monday. I had to make out a simple form where I had to answer some questions. Are you living in fear in your home? And I felt like writing in, only before God. Are you afraid of your spouse / significant other? I don't know what a significant other is, and I don't fear my spouse, and she don't fear me, and this is none of your business. But I guess, I suppose, in this day and age, this is how it's supposed to be. And that's sad, isn't it? Can you believe that's where we've gotten? By the way, and this is not cutting this message short, unfortunately, but I got to bring this up. How many of you live near a school? Raise your hand. Okay. Do you remember, some of you, you would remember, Norm, you, when was it that you were driving a bus? Okay. I remember going to public school when I was in elementary school. We walked to school. How many of you remember walking to school? No problem. Sometimes we'd walk a great distance to school. No sweat. There would be the occasional bus that would come in. No problem. But the fact of the matter is we could walk. We live not too far from, is it a middle school? No, it's an elementary school. That's right, it's an elementary school. I can't believe the hundreds of cars that come in now. Parents don't want their kids walking. They got to bring them in themselves, and they've got to pick them up, which creates an incredible traffic jam. But the fact of the matter is, when it comes to their children, people live in fear nowadays in America. That's sad. That's sad. Now there's the head of the home. There was the heart of the home. Let's look to the head of the home. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, recognition of the marriage relationship. You are to love them as Christ loved the church. Giving, assigning to, in other words, this is, it's not something that she earns. This is something you give her by command. Giving honor, the word honor there has the idea that that person is precious. You are to give them honor. You assign it to them, it's theirs. They don't earn it, it's theirs, period, because of who they are. Giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel. Not that she's against, just physically weaker, but it has to do as an instrument, as in the temple. There were instruments that were used that were greater, others that were not as great, and as being heirs together of the grace of life. You are, my wife is as much a child of God as I am. Again, that does not take place in Islam. It doesn't take place in other religions. It takes place in biblical Christianity, that your prayers be not hindered. I'll tell you what, that'll keep a preacher right with his wife. Because if we have an argument, and it's my fault or even her fault, and I decide, we're not going to settle this thing, I'm not getting into the pulpit Sunday morning with the power of God. Because I might have prayed for it, and the Lord says, you haven't taken care of something. There was a vow that you made, and you have broken that vow. Get back to me. That's pretty good. And by the way, guys, it's the same with you. So we need to hear this out. If we want our prayers heard tonight, fellas, this is what we take care of. Amen, guys? Amen, ladies? Okay. So quickly, that was in the family, but also in the fellowship. Speaking, by the way, of making it hard, we can do this in the church as well. We can make it hard for the Lord to hear our prayers. He says, finally, verse 8, be ye all of one mind. Now, wait a second. It's not that everybody thinks the exact same way on everything. But the church is going a certain direction, isn't it? We are following Christ, right? When Peter says, be ye all of one mind, he says, every person in the fellowship. You're not living for yourself, you're living for Christ. And that's why, be it in the Sunday school or from the pulpit, that there is teaching, there is direction, that look, it's worthy to follow him. That's why I preached what I preached this morning on the calling. And it breaks my heart, you know, when you stop and consider that there are people that are still stiff-arming God when it comes to the call of God on their life. How many of you have come to find out that the call of God, it's the greatest thing to rest in? You found that out? It's wonderful. So he says, when it comes to these things, when it comes to the major, obviously the major points of Christian doctrine and practice, be all of one mind. Is Jesus who he said he is? God come in the flesh? There we go. Is the local church the entity that the Lord uses to get his message out? Yes. So that's what we recognize. And in this fellowship, he says, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one from another. This, you know, this phrase here is where we get the word sympathy. It means to have a fellow feeling. You know, I praise God. When my mom was going through what she was going through, there were so many other people. Hey, I'm praying. Praise God for that. I'm so glad for that. And other situations that have taken place with people in the church. I mean, you're hurting. I love how Jim Benny, when he was here, he described it. Said some guy came across a situation one day, and he found a group of children gathered around a little boy that was on the ground. And he walked up, and there was a little boy, and he was on the ground, and he was hurt. He's like, oh, yeah. And the kids that were standing around him were doing the same thing. They were holding their stomach. And he said to a little girl, what's going on? And she said, we're all having a pain in Jimmy's stomach. That's called sympathy. It's a sympathy pain. When it comes to this, we are sympathizing with each other. A fellow feeling. Look at what he says. Love as brethren. Be loving brethren. Or be brethren who are loving. And again, with what we heard last night from Brother Bill Snodderly, that was tremendous. It makes me want to go back and study 1 Corinthians 13 all over again, although he did a great job when he was expounding that last night. Be loving, brethren. Be pitiful means full of pity. The Greek word actually means tender-hearted. This is how we're to be. Again, he's describing, this is the local church. If somebody was to take and try to describe a local church that appeals to the world, they would use words like exciting, vibrant, fast-paced, you know, all that. That's not what's coming out here, is it? The world is looking for something that really gets the flesh going. That's not what we need. What we need is that which radiates from the inside that he's talking about here. So a church that loves his brethren, that is pitiful, they're tender-hearted. One of the people I was reading says the first century church was cold and hard-hearted. And by the way, it was, when you live in a culture where over half the citizens are slaves, that's cold. Here came biblical Christianity. And pretty soon that edifice, because of its sin, like we were talking about this morning, how many civilizations now have absolutely crumbled to the ground? Every one of them because of their sin. Because of their sin. It's the same thing here with biblical Christianity. Rome began to crumble, and all Satan could do in order to stop the advance of true biblical Christianity, he had to make a copycat, which he did with Rome. He did that. Instead, if he hadn't done that, there were estimates that the entire Roman empire could have been won to Christ by 500 AD. Fascinating. Be pitiful, be courteous. In other words, humble-minded, having a modest opinion of one's self. Folks, we don't have a pecking order here. Amen? We don't have a pecking order here, and we don't need it. By the way, I grew up in a time in church where there was a real lifting up of mankind in certain instances. We learned our lesson. Some learned it the hard way. We don't need that. When I talk about the two men that are coming Tuesday night, I talk about them because of how the Lord has used them. And I guarantee you, you talk to them, and they are humble-minded. They are humble-minded. So, be courteous, humble-minded. Look at verse 9. Not rendering evil for evil. Literally, not giving back evil for evil or railing for railing. But contrarywise, blessing. Be constantly blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. There is coming that time when God is going to bless us in heaven. He blesses us here on earth. You want to be blessed? You be a blessing. You give a blessing. Verse 10, for he that will love life, if this is your action, he who is wishing or desiring to be loving life, the idea he who is loving life and wishes to continue to do so and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil. Why does he use the word refrain? Because what does James tell us about the tongue? It's a poison. It's full of deadly poison. It's just going like crazy. If you don't take care of it, he says, hey, the tongue is a world of iniquity. You know, it's hard to hold that thing back, isn't it? So he says, for he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. Keep it. Verse 11, let him eschew, shun or avoid evil and do good. Let him speak peace and ensue it. In other words, pursue it. You know, there's nothing better, the Bible says, for the brethren, that the brethren dwell together in unity. The best thing to do, the absolute best thing to do, is to seek the Lord in every situation so that there is the peace of God that passes all understanding. I remember hearing the story. Oh, I can't remember what nation it was in World War II, but there were two groups of churches. The one went underground, the other didn't. They went along with the government for a while to allow themselves to continue worshiping. At the end of the war, there was animosity between the two groups. The leadership of the two groups came together. There were tears, there was confession of sin, there was all this. But at the end of the day, they all came out and somebody said, well, what happened? He said, well, we came out as one. That was peace. I'm so glad that that's the kind of God that we have. When you read about Allah, the moon god, you read about a God that loves to kill. You don't read about the love of man, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's why Islam emphasizes Allah had no son. No, Allah don't have no son. In fact, he doesn't have much of anything because he doesn't really exist. But God does. God does. Look at verse 11. Look at verse 12. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Here we are. We're gathered at 3501 Q Street, North Highlands, California. If you were to take Google Earth and zoom out to where you could see all of North America, you couldn't see where we are. You could zoom in a little bit more, see the state of California. You can't see where we are. you zoom into the Sacramento area and you start to see certain things. You see streets, roads, et cetera, et cetera. But you would have to really zoom in to see the picture of this place. And even still, you couldn't look inside the building. This is what God does. He can be out. He can inhabit eternity. But he's here. And not only is he looking, that word over, it literally means upon. He is looking upon this place. He's watching. I wonder what he sees. That same one that looks on the righteous, he takes his face and he turns against those that do evil. I would be absolutely terrified to be living a life where the God of heaven was my enemy. But not only that, it says he's upon the righteous, he's looking, but his ears are open to their prayers. Isn't it great that the Lord's going to hear us? I love that. I don't know how he'll respond. I just know this. My God knows. Verse 13, last verse. And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? After we just read, you know, it's kind of like there in Romans, if God be for us, who can be against us? It's the same thing here. If you're followers of good, who can bring you harm? Who can do it? The answer is in the question. There's no one. There's absolutely no one. The only way that something happens to us is if God decides he's going to use our suffering for his glory. Just like when you read 2 Peter, and he knew what was about to take place. Peter knew that because the Lord told him that he was going to die for him. He wasn't in a tizzy about it. He wasn't weeping or crying or wanting to escape. The Lord just said, this is what's going to happen. It's the same thing with us. There's a way I want our nation, I would desire our nation to go. I would love to see revival. When you read about things that have taken place in time past, and you read about how God moved, it's like, Lord, do it again. Do it again. Do it again. But you know what? Our God knows what he's doing. And if he had to take Job to show how he was ruling over all, if he had to take Paul to show that sometimes it's the blood of the martyrs that's the seed of the church, if he had to do that, then Lord, you know what you're doing in 2017 the same way you knew what you were doing in the first century. So with that, we have finished right here up through verse 13. Heavenly Father, Lord, now as we go to prayer, pray that you'd hear us. Lord, thank you for the truth that we have just read, that we have peered into. It's such a joy that we're just not simply cast out into this life to do the best we can. Our Savior walks with us. And Lord, as we alluded to this morning, whatever we walk through on the outside, we know that we can do it as long as we're walking with you on the inside. So Lord, I pray that each and every person would have that passion, that desire to walk with thee. And now, Lord, bless in this time, I pray. In Christ's name, amen.